Hello and welcome, and on the bench tonight we have an Atari Power Brick and AR2 audio regulator PCB from a Battlezone upright cabinet. So we're trying to get a bunch of machines working again after some board repairs have come back, and we're just doing some vigilance and checking power supplies and things. Now, the reason it's here on the bench is because the power supply brick was playing up for us when we had it at the unit. So I've brought it home to test on the bench because I have a whole bench test rig and everything like that that I can use for it. So this is more of a kind of a cautionary tale for those, anybody starting out with power supplies and things like that. So this transformer up here takes a main input of 240 volts this side and then spits out a whole bunch of different voltages here. Now this is only a lab connection, so I haven't got the right. I did have the correct connector for the later model Atari bricks, which is that one. I've taken the pins out of it because this is a smaller form factor 15 pin. And on the Battlezone cabinet, they used a slightly different, Molex AMP connector. I don't know what the code number for it is, but for the purposes of bench testing, this is absolutely fine, and all the connections aren't going to touch because that block ain't moving. It's nice and heavy. Anyway, coming out from. Over here we have, from the transformer, through some fuses down here, and it's usually F3, by the way, that you have a lot of problems with, and I'll come back to that in a second. Over here you have 10.3 volts unregulated, and we have 36 volts AC at that side. Now, what I wanted to do was to make sure that the amplifier worked, and that the voltages were all correct. So what I've done is I've hooked these two lines up. These are the only power inputs to the AR2. So there's your 10.3 and your ground. And over this side is your 36 volt AC. Your 36 volts stays on this side and seems to be responsible mostly for generating 22 volts. And if the modules were plugged into it, there'd be 15 volts plus and minus there. You can populate the board for it. There's also 12 volts and minus 5 test points down here as well. So I've been around the board and I've checked those and I'm happy with what's outputting. So the next thing I came to was the amplifier section and the plus 5 section. So the plus 5 is over here and you have an adjustment pot just here. Now sometimes it has a bit of glue on it to stop you from moving it because it's been factory preset. What I was doing was I was measuring the voltage and I was getting a weird voltage, something like 0.5 volts or something there. It turns out that a lot of it's to do with how the schematic looks on it. Anyway, we'll come back to the 5 volt section in a moment. What I want to do is just demonstrate the amplifier is working on this. So, on this J7 connector over here, and I'm sort of mad professor kind of going off at a different angle and everything, J7 has ground and it has your audio left and right input. I've got the audio left and right via a straightforward socket down here, which is then connected over here to my phone. So, and then the speaker is plugged onto terminal 1 output and ground, so it's got its return for the speaker. I'm just going to power the unit up, and I'm going to press play on the phone over here. I'm using the phone as a source for the music. There we go. And that proves that the music is working. If I take the connector off speaker 1 there and push it onto speaker 2 there, you can hear what would be the second channel on the amplifier working because it's a stereo amp. So return that to speaker 1, get back on there, no problems. Okay, so that's enough of the audio section. By the way, if you want the music, look up. It was provided by Ben Foster, Purity, from UK VAC, who did a little test of the Soft Synth TB-303 Acid synthesizer, which I was very impressed with, and some samples from a sample pack that you can get online. Anyway, so back to so that proves the amplifier section is working. It also proves that this brick is working under load. I mean, we nickname it brick because it's heavy like a brick. Voltage coming out, going to the AR, and what I was getting was about half a volt when I was trying to test it. And that's all down to the schematic here. So your input is over this side here. 10.3 comes in. on this connector, and then flows through this TIP32, the LM305, the 2N3055, and eventually becomes 5 volts out here on 5 and 6. Okay, now, the problem that I was having was I'm thinking, well, why am I only getting half a volt? Well, because this is a linear power supply, what you have to do is you have an adjustment thing here and you have to put a load on the end. So I've got a load over here, and I put that onto the end of it, which is a 330 ohm, I think it's a 10 watt resistor, that one. And that will then drag the voltage down to 12 millivolts. So I've spent quite a few hours probably about an hour and a half chasing my tail around this schematic, testing components, trying to find out what the heck's wrong. Nothing seems to be actually wrong. No components seem to be dead. Everything seems to be, what's going on? Anyway, what Atari did, and I've seen it on a few other power supplies as well, is they put this sense circuit in over here. Now, you've probably heard about something called SenseMod. But if you're bench testing it, you're supposed to just put a load on the 5-volt line, and hey presto, it's supposed to then work. However, what this would do is it would start here, and it would go out over to the PCB. And the PCB would return the voltage back then, the sense plus and minus. So effectively, returning it 5-volt and ground from the other end, down the other end of the cable. And what that would do is it would signal to the board whether it needs to do any adjustments or anything like that to the voltage. Now, one of the big problems with AR2s is that they could potentially dump anything up to 9 volts out into the 5 volt rail, and you don't want that. That's going to kill your PCB. So what a lot of people do is something called a sense mod. And under lab conditions for testing, it's kind of important that you know about this, because otherwise you're probably not going to be able to test your 5 volts unless you wire up the circuit in a what I'd consider a bit of a non-standard way and start looping 5 volts through to sense ground and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I couldn't adjust the 5 volts. And the 5 volt adjust is here on this 1K resistor, variable resistor, which is this blue one down here that was pointed out before. The problem was, the problem is the way the circuit is arranged. So 5 volts leaves over here, but then this feedback circuit, which governs the voltage, is here. And it's all been sort of geared up with having something returning down that path. Now, what I will do in future is I will make myself an extra couple of wires to go on this connector here to basically feed sense plus into sense plus and 5 volts together, and sense minus and ground together on this connector, so that I can do basically a 5 volt test at that point without any trouble. Now, what I've done here is I've done the sense mod to it underneath, and immediately as I've done that, I've been able to get a nice stable voltage. And if I adjust this variable resistor over here, you watch this voltage move, so that's now going down and plummeting, 4.5. And I can bring it all the way back up, and I can take it really high if I want to. There's nothing on the end of it apart from that resistor, and it will go up as far as 5.48 adjusted, which is about right. So I'm going to bring it down now, and I'm going to preset this back down nice and low, because we've been advised to try and run these boards a little bit lower, and I concur. I'm going to try and bring it down to about 4.85. And then we'll put the Battlezone PCB on the end of it, and hopefully that'll provide a bit more life for it and all the rest of it. So what I'll do now is I'll turn this off and I'll just show you underneath the sense mod. So we're de-energising the power supply, and I'll take my test connectors off it, like so. Just enough that I can flip the thing over and show you. Yeah, take the two speaker connectors off, don't need those. And that should be enough. So I'm going to flip it over, and what's going to happen is when I'm going to flip it that way, so this connector here ends up down at the bottom. Ta-da! Right. So, there we have a sense modification. So what I've done is I've bridged pins 1 and 2 together, which is, according to the schematic, that is your 5 volt return and your sense minus. Fine. And I've also joined 3 and 6 together here with a simple link, and that joins plus 5 and sense plus. Now, the reason to do it here is because the board, the AR2 then will push out voltage, but immediately see the same voltage back. So it means that you will always have control over it, and hopefully what should happen now is it should never try and dump 9 volts down there. The problem was that the edge connectors on the games would get quite worn and then would provide resistance, which would then mean there'd be a difference in voltage between what was being pushed out at the 5-volt point here and what was coming back to it here. Sorry, I've got the 2 points the wrong way around, but you get what I'm saying. So it goes out on plus 5 out and comes back on to plus 10. And the problem was that it was basically there's a difference. So the voltage circuit here, the auto compensation circuit, would then push the voltage back up more to try and compensate, so it would get an equal 5-volt reading, and then things would get hotter because there's more load going on the edge of it, and then the boards would get warmer, and then eventually there was so much voltage being pushed down into it that it would start frying components and the game would fail. So, nice idea, Atari. Unfortunately, epic fail on pretty longevity. Although, you know, we go back to the argument that Atari never really intended these games to still be running 30-something years later. Anyway, hope you find that interesting. And just for the new players like myself who don't usually get on too well with power supplies, sound amps, no problems anymore. Can get them sorted out. Just venturing into power supplies and try to make sure all these linear ones are all right, and so we don't end up with a mass amount of board repairs every 5 minutes. So just a cautionary tale. When you set up a bench loom, if you want schematics for all this, just drop me an email and I'll try and draw them up. And the wiring's fairly straightforward, but if anybody needs it, yeah, no problem. If you want to buy a test harness or something like that, then I can certainly sort something out. Drop me an email. Anyway, I hope you find it useful. We'll get back to the Tron video next time. Hopefully, I've got a number of PCBs sat down there on the floor. And over there, and a box full as well to go through and test. We've done some work on it already, and we'll get back to that because it's exciting stuff, and I should be able to get the game running in the next week or so. All right, so anyway, have fun, and do subscribe to the channel if you haven't done already, and we'll see you on the next video. Thanks for watching. Catch you next time.